Okay. So good morning. We will having a ward round discussion today on chest injury. Chest injury is a very important topic. We will have my either in the theory exam or in the ward round scenario you have chest injury. So you go as the examiner takes you through. Dr. Shomita Chatterjee, Professor of Surgery at IBGMR, will take us through the scenario. Just look at the scenario and then let Dr. Chatterjee ask you questions.
Does he have a scenario ready with him or shall I give him a scenario?
Yeah.
Oh, he has a scenario. Okay, fine. Yeah. Dr. Atik, yeah.
Yes, so
can
morning.
You just read out your scenario?
Good morning. A 38-year-old gentleman involved in an RTA post which he was brought to the emergency. On arrival, patient has come, respiratory rate with 30 per minute. How will you proceed?
Okay, so you tell me, you are the medical officer in the emergency, how would you like to proceed? Is there anything else you would like to know before you proceed?
Yeah, first I will do the normal ATLS protocol of CABCD. I will check immediately check for any external source
you.
Of bleeding. Or...
I think you said in ATLS protocol of, what did you say?
Trauma. Sorry.
No, yeah, what did you say? ATLS protocol and then you said something else. CABCD.
CABCD, yes, sir. Yes,
no. So ATLS protocol, let's guess things first. That is the ACLS, the cardiac protocol that you talked about. ATLS protocol does not start with circulation. ATLS protocol always starts with airway. Okay? So CABC, AC, cardiac light scope protocol. So don't mix up the two. Okay? So talk slowly so that everybody can understand what you're saying. Right.
Okay.
So you want to initiate the ATLS protocol. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So to initiate the ATLS protocol, what is the first thing that you're going to do?
I will check for any...
What is the first thing? The patient has come to the emergency.
Yes, ma'am. I will check for airway of the patient. I will check whether there is external source of bleeding, any exsanguinating source of bleeding. And following which, I will check the airway of the patient. I will evaluate the airway of the patient by doing a chin lift or...
Atik, once you uttered, you will follow ATLS protocol. Go by ATLS protocol. ATLS protocol does not say to look for bleeding first and airway. ATLS protocol has three components: primary survey and resuscitation, secondary survey, and the definitive management. So you are in the primary survey and resuscitation. Yeah. So talk of that. And that starts with ABCD, not B first and then A. Okay, so
okay,
your answer is right. Approach is very good.
What ATLS will you protocol. Do? So what by ATLS protocol, what is the first thing that you're going to do?
You will check for airway patency, ma'am.
You will check for airway patency. How are you going to check for airway patency? What are you going to do or...
I will first look at the patient to see whether he is suffering from any air hunger or air hunger, and then I will assess.
Your patient is unconscious, so he is not exhibiting any air hunger.
I will do
how
a.
How will you proceed?
I will do a chin lift and jaw thrust, ma'am. And if it is available, then we can do a video laryngoscopy if it's available. Otherwise, I will intubate my patient.
No.
See,
the first A is not.
Dr. Atik, hold on. I think you're jumping the guns, okay? See, when you say airway assessment, the first thing any trauma patient who comes in, you have to give him oxygen, okay? Whatever be the status, even if he's a walking, talking patient, give benefit of doubt and start oxygen to the patient.
Okay.
Second is you're saying, I'm going to assess airway. Assess has quite a few components. The first component is ask the patient his name. Or what happened? How did you have the accident? If he can say that I was riding a bike and I was hit by a car or whatever, if he is able to verbalize, it means it at least as of this moment. Okay? So if he can talk, half the war is won because you know that the airway is patent. If not, yes. If the patient is not talking, then you open the mouth and look into the mouth to see whether there is anything obstructing the airway. What are the things which can obstruct the airway in a trauma scenario?
Any foreign body, ma'am. Secondly, if there is any neck hematoma following the trauma. And third, it can be also obstructed due to edema of the trachea itself.
Okay. See, the point is an edema sets in, does not set in so fast. So yes, foreign body, I agree. The more common thing is secretions. It could be secretions of the patient. It could be blood within the mouth. It could be bleeding from somewhere. So if there are any secretions, any bleeding, any foreign body, it could be a misplaced denture in a patient who is carrying a denture. So these are the things that you look into. So you've looked inside and you see some secretions there. What do you do?
I'll first aspirate all the secretions.
What do you? Okay, so you will suck out the contents or whatever the foreign body is, you remove it, and then you see whether he can talk or not.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so given that so you've started oxygen, you've inspected the mouth. If there are any foreign bodies or secretions of blood, you've sucked it out. What do you do next? What are the things that you try to hear for? If the patient is talking, fair enough. If not, what are the things you'll be hearing?
I'll try to auscultate breath sounds bilaterally and also for heart sounds, if it is muffled or not, to rule out the...
Hold on, Dr. Atik, you're rushing. You are not into heart sounds now. What are the things you're going to hear? Your ears. You do not use a stethoscope. There are certain things that you're going to hear.
I will percuss to note any hyperresonant sound over the chest to rule out...
Percussion is not hearing. Okay. No, Dr. Atik. Percussion, you will just hear whether there are any sounds that he is making. Is there a gurgling sound? Is there a snoring sound? Is there a stridor? These are the things which will give you a hint as to whether there is an airway obstruction. So if he is talking, fair enough. If not, be alert to other sounds. Snoring, gurgling, stridor, these sounds that you are... Okay. So if the patient is making these sounds, what do you think? That possibly there is a partial obstruction of the airway and you have to open up the airway. Okay. So now you, as I said, you have to open up the airway. How are you going to open up the airway?
Emergency, we can do a cricothyroidotomy.
No. That is much later. Initial opening up of the airway.
Jaw thrust and chin lift.
Absolutely correct. So you can do either a jaw thrust or a chin lift. This opens up the... Okay, you've done a jaw thrust and a chin lift and you see that the snoring is going subdued, but the moment you're doing the thrust, it is coming back. What do you infer from this?
Ma'am, I could not hear the last part. Sorry.
You've done an... You run a lift and a thrust, okay, and you see that the gurgling has decreased.
Yes, ma'am.
Can you hear me, Atik? Yes, okay.
Yes, ma'am, I can hear you. It's a bit
connection choppy.
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yes, ma'am.
Sound is breaking, literally.
I wanted to know that you've done a chin lift or a jaw thrust and then the snoring had decreased.
Okay.
Now, once the snoring has decreased, you release the chin lift and you see that the snoring comes back again. So what will you infer from this? What else do you have to do now?
Sorry, ma'am, I am not sure.
Okay. See, if you do a chin lift, that means you're opening up the airway.
Yes.
But if the sound comes back again, that means he is not able to maintain that opening. So you have to put in an oropharyngeal airway. You do not directly jump to a cricothyroid. You put in an oropharyngeal airway and see whether the patient is venting. Okay. In addition to all these things that you're doing, what will you ask your nurse to do? Your nursing person, what will you ask her to do?
I will ask her to draw a blood sample and also for a chest x-ray.
No, we are still at the very basic thing.
Okay.
We are still trying to assess the airway. So how can she help you?
She can take the vitals and also undress the patient.
Okay, so most important is attach the monitors.
Attach the monitors.
In 2021, you cannot say that I do not have a monitor. So attach the monitors. What are the things that you're going to see on the monitor?
See the respiratory rate, the pulse rate, not the respiratory, sorry, ma'am, pulse rate, the blood pressure and the SpO2.
Yes, and also the respiratory rate. If you have a good monitor, that will also show your respiratory rate.
Yes,
so you look at the pulse, you look at the BP, you look at the saturation, and you look at the respiratory rate.
Yes,
now, your patient, the patient you have here, has a respiratory rate of 30.
Yes, ma'am.
Right?
Yes,
so
ma'am.
What is your concern?
That he might go into respiratory failure, ma'am.
Okay, that means what? What? Okay, he might go into respiratory failure, but what sort of injury do you think he may have sustained to have a respiratory rate like this? What sort of injury can contribute to a raised respiratory rate?
Tension, any blunt trauma to the blunt trauma to the tension pneumothorax, ma'am, or cardiac tamponade can raise the tension.
So type of injury will mean that he may have sustained some injury to the thorax.
To thorax, yes, ma'am. Chest injury.
Right. So because see, we are doing a class based on road traffic accident with thoracic injury. So focus your mind on that. That probably he has some injury to the thorax. So
Dr. Chatterjee, you are not audible.
Airway associated injury, you can have a breathing associated.
Sound is not clear. Dr. Samita.
You can have a circulation associated injury. Okay.
Dr. Samita, it was not audible. Sound issues. Okay, Dr. Atik.
Yes.
Now
sir,
you
sir.
Think that patient has got a chest injury.
Yes, sir.
So apart from going to now ABCD have done, now you thought the patient has got patient does not have a head injury, he is conscious, he has got a isolated chest injury.
Yes, sir.
So what are the different spectra of chest injury patient may have following a rotary accident?
He can have six, it can be divided into two types, six deadly injuries and six provisionally, six can be fatal injuries. We have to exclude the first six fatal injuries that can occur. It can be airway obstruction, tension pneumothorax, massive hemothorax, and open pneumothorax, flail chest or pericardial tamponade, sir. And it can also.
So how will you diagnose? How will you diagnose that patient has got a pneumothorax? Just a pneumothorax, not tension. Pneumothorax.
Only pneumothorax. Okay. So, the lung. We can do a X-ray immediately, sir. It will show a pneumothorax. Clinically, sir, it will be a resonant sound on the effect. On percussion, it will appear resonant on the affected side, and. Breath sounds will be decreased, but in a lying down patient, the lung may float. So breath sounds will be decreased, sir, and the neck veins will be engorged. Patient will have hypotension, and patient will have hypotension, sir.
That happens in tension pneumothorax, is it?
Okay, sir.
Patient has got a pneumothorax. First of all, he'll have respiratory distress.
Yes, sir.
He may have pain because of acid rib injury.
Yes, sir.
This pneumothorax may also be the acid rib injury. So patient may have chest pain because of the fractured rib. And then if you look at the chest movement, the movement will be decreased on that particular side.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes,
and then you percuss and then listen to the stethoscope.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes. So when you say patient has got tension pneumothorax, what happens in tension pneumothorax?
Sir, clinically, sir.
Yes, first clinically.
Yes, sir. Clinically, if the patient is... if the patient shows signs of air hunger, that is, he is breathing, there is no airway obstruction, but still his SpO2 is decreasing.
What happens? What is the pathology in tension pneumothorax?
One way valve is
created, I say, sir, is pneumothorax, and then the pathology in tension pneumothorax is what?
attention pneumothorax is created when a one way valve is created either from the lung or from the chest wall. That is, air is entering but not able to exit, sir.
Yes, then what happens?
It leads to compression of the lung and pushes the pleura to the opposite side, leading to compression of the opposite lung, and also it leads to compression of the blood vessel. So that is decreasing the venous return, and hence decreasing the cardiac, hence decreasing the cardiac ventricular filling, and hence the cardiac output at lung.
Yes. So this patient may go into cardiac arrest.
Yes, sir.
If it's not correct. So intention pneumothorax, patient has got associated tachycardia, hypotension.
Yes, sir.
And patient may have respiratory failure and cardiac tamponade features.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So how do you relieve this patient? Patient has got tension pneumothorax. You have no time to go for theater. Patient in emergency. Sir.
We'll do a, I'll just put a wide bore cannula in the second intercostal space in the midclavicular line to relieve the pressure. And then, sir, I will, and if the patient is stabilized, following which I will do a ICD placement.
How will you diagnose hemothorax? How will you diagnose hemothorax?
So hemothorax on, so it will appear same as the clinical signs will be same like raised, neck veins will be collapsed, sir, in hemothorax due to bleeding. But cardiac other features will be same like decreased BP and also it will be dull on percussion, sir.
And breath sounds?
Breath sounds will be muffled. Breath sounds will be absent, sir. But if the patient is lying down, sometimes the lungs may float up and then we can hear normal breath sounds.
Okay. Now come to some chest wall injuries.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So you have a patient who has got a localized pain in the chest and on examination you find there is a crepitus, but he does not have a respiratory distress. What do you suspect?
Crepitus, sir, crepitus means there is most likely surgical emphysema. Surgical emphysema suggests that there is...
One is surgical emphysema and second is if there is a rib fracture, if you keep your finger there, as the chest expands, there may be friction between the two fractured ends. That also may create a crepitus.
Crepitus.
So crepitus, one is saphenous emphysema, you mean, that is underlying lung injury.
Yes.
We just say crepitus because of bony friction, it may rib fracture.
Yes, sir.
So you have a patient who has got an isolated rib fracture.
Okay, sir.
How are you going to evaluate this patient? This patient has got an isolated rib fracture.
If the patient is stable with oxygen, I will give the patient oxygen therapy. If he is able to sustain with that and with adequate analgesia, even including opiate, and then I will not do any further.
What is the concern in a patient who has got even isolated rib fracture? What is the concern?
Pulmonary contusion, sir, leading to hypoxia.
And? One is pulmonary contusion and second is this sharp fracture end can cause what?
Lung parenchyma injury, so it can cause pneumothorax.
So the concern is that. Concern is patient may have acid lung contusion and patient may have acid pneumothorax.
Yes, sir.
So you have to exclude clinically whether the patient has got this. Otherwise, if the patient does not have lung contusion or pneumothorax, what should be the optimal treatment?
So oxygen therapy and adequate analgesia, sir.
Yes. And what else?
And
if the patient does not take a breathing because of pain?
Then we will have to intubate the patient, sir. Positive pressure ventilation.
No. Isolated rib fracture didn't need intubation. No, don't confuse.
Okay.
Intubation is the last. Isolated rib fracture, you have to give the patient adequate analgesia.
Yes, sir.
And you have to ask the patient to take deep breathing exercise.
Deep breathing exercise. Physiotherapy,
yes, sir. If the patient tries to take a deep breathing, there may be lung collapse on their side. So next is a adequate breathing exercise.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now you come to the point that patient has got a situation called as flail chest. What do you mean by flail chest?
So as per Bellilov, it's a consecutive fracture of more than three ribs in two or more places. More than three consecutive ribs in two or more places.
Not more than three. Three or more ribs. More than
three or, three or more ribs. Sir.
Three more or than more two. Ribs.
Yes.
At two or more.
Two
points.
Or more places.
Okay. So that has happened. What do you mean by flail chest? Why it is called flail chest?
So because that part is that part creates a separate entity, sir, which shows paradoxical respiration. That is, it moves inside during inspiration and is moves outside during expiration, sir.
Why this flail segment moves inside during inspiration? What is the mechanism?
Yes, because during inspiration, our intrathoracic pressure is negative, so that air from outside comes inside. As this portion is not attached to the remaining of the chest, remaining of the rib cage, it acts on the basis of atmospheric pressure. So as the intrathoracic pressure is negative, it moves, it gets sucked in, and vice versa.
Okay. So one railway patient having a flail segment, what may be the consequences? What may be the consequences on this patient?
So, sir, it can, the flail chest can produce voluntary, it generally produces voluntary splinting in this patients, and for that the patient can have pulmonary consolidation. So the patient due to parenchymal injury, it can lead to hypoxia. Due to inability of the lung to move freely, there will be hypoxia in this patient.
You see, try to understand, if the patient has got a significant flail segment,
yes,
that flail segment is drawn inward during inspiration. So what can happen to the underlying lung? I'm not talking of injury.
Okay,
injury is one part. Even if there is no parenchymal injury, that part of lung cannot expand.
Fully expand, sir. Yes.
So what is going to happen?
So hypoxia, sir.
How? That part of lung is not, that part of lung is normally perfused.
Yes, sir.
But that part of lung is not ventilated. So there is ventilation perfusion mismatch.
Mismatch. Yes.
There is ventilation mismatch. So if it is a large segment, patient will have hypoxia.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So when you talk of flail chest, there are different types of flail chest depending on the site. What do you mean by that? What are the different types?
One is, sir, Stovin chest.
Now, Stovin chest is not exactly flail chest. Stovin chest, I'll come to that. What may be the different types of flail chest depending on the which site is involved?
So anterior, lateral, and posterior. Sir.
Yes, good. Anterior means central flail chest.
Central flail chest. What is involving that? The costochondral junction, sir.
Where?
On the anterior part of the chest, involving the costochondral junction, sir.
On one side or both side?
On one side, sir.
No.
No. It's both sides, anterior.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
So central flail chest is when you have the junction of the manubrium sternum with the ribs cage.
Yes, sir.
Causing central indentation of the manubrium sternum. So yes, that is, yes, central flail chest. And what is lateral flail chest?
So that involves the shaft of the ribs.
Yes. On one side. In two or more places.
Two or more
that
places.
That segment goes inward.
Yes, sir.
Okay. There is a term called a major flail chest or a minor flail chest. What is that? When you say this patient has got a major flail chest, may require intensive treatment. Both require intensive treatment, but what do you mean by major flail chest?
I don't know, sir.
In major flail chest, you have a major segment of chest wall which is lying flail, and that will lead to respiratory distress and hypoxemia.
Okay, sir.
If you do ABG, if you, yes, do ABG, you'll find the oxygen tension be less. So if that particular flail segment is not causing respiratory distress or patient does not have ABG alteration, that means these are the patients who are maintaining in spite of this flail segment. These are minor flail chest.
Okay,
and if the patient has got gross ABG alteration with hypoxemia, that is a major flail chest. How are you going to manage a patient who has got a significant flail chest?
So we can fix that segment by giving external.
Don't jump with the fixation first. Patient has got a flail chest. You have diagnosed in emergency, and where this patient should be admitted? In the ward or somewhere else?
ICU, sir.
Yes. So you first admit the patient in intensive care unit for proper monitoring.
Yes, sir.
And then you start monitoring with his blood pressure, his saturation, his pulse rate.
Yes.
Okay. So intensive care unit is that site where the patient is admitted. And yes, what are the components of management of a patient who has got a major flail chest? Components of management. What is the most important?
Oxygen saturation, sir.
Yes. How do you maintain?
So by giving high flow oxygen at the rate of 15 liters per minute, sir.
That is one, oxygen therapy. What else?
Second, sir. Now.
This is a situation of multiple rib fracture.
Yes, sir.
So, we have most to, important aspect of is what? Analgesics.
Yes,
fixation comes much later. Now there are some school, they say early fixation, but the most important is very good pain control. If the pain is not controlled, patient will not take a breathing and patient will have further hypoxemia.
Yes.
So good analgesic for pain control. Second is, there are two ways that you can maintain this situation with proper oxygenation. What? How to maintain? Now, if you see, the earlier dictum was you should ventilate all these patients.
Yes, sir.
Elective ventilation. But there are some studies that are saying that if you can apply CPAP, you can apply CPAP, okay, you can give oxygenated mask with end pressure.
Yes.
Okay, so that can maintain the lung expansion in spite of the flail segment. So you can go for non-invasive ventilation or you have to go for ventilation.
Ventilation, sir.
Okay, and how long it usually takes for this flail segment to get stabilized if the patient is on ventilation?
Sir,
the flail segment usually gets stabilized.
Yes,
how long
sir.
It takes?
So 7 to 10 days, sir.
No, 2 to 4 weeks. These are the patient, if the patient has got a major flail change, this patient may take 2 to 4 weeks to get stabilized.
Okay.
Okay. So, ventilation. What are the other components of management? You said one is pain control. Second is maintaining the oxygen saturation, either by a max ventilation and positive pressure ventilation. What else are the management in these patients?
So, chest physiotherapy, as you mentioned, sir.
Yes.
Deep breathing exercises.
Yes. What else?
Later if the patient requires, then we'll do a fixation, sir. Sorry.
And what some other thing has to be addressed. You see, this is a patient who is critically ill, he is in ICU, you have addressed his pain, you have addressed the hypoxia by ventilation, and what else need to be addressed? What about nutrition?
Yes, sir.
So you should take care. If give the patient ventilation in 2 to 4 weeks, you have to keep in mind that patient should be properly given nutrition.
Nutrition, sir.
Okay, either by a tube feeding or by parenteral nutrition. Because yes, if the patient is literally exhausted, you cannot bring the patient off from ventilator.
Yes.
And these are the patients who are critically ill on ventilator. What else you should keep in mind? And you always give. You always give that drug in critically ill patient. That is, you have to give some PPI.
PPIs.
PPI to prevent
gastritis.
To prevent stress ulcer.
Stress ulcer, stress gastritis.
And you have to take the skin care. You have to provide
bed
skin care.
Yes, sir. Prevent bed sores.
Yeah. Dr. Samita, you came back?
Sir, sir. I've just joined back, sir. Sorry,
okay,
sir.
Okay, no problem. So I asking him, about
sir.
Management of fracture reef. And I've gone through the how do you define a flail chest, what happens in flail chest,
okay,
and what are the components of management of flail chest.
So, right, sir.
Because repeatedly emphasizing on that fixation. You see, what's your concept about fixing the flail segment?
So it can be, it requires generally internal fixation, that is, it is fixed to the ribs and also to the skin.
Now, is it a routine that you do fixation for all patients?
No, sir. If it's if the patient is stabilized and breathing properly, it gets automatically healed, sir. But if
there are two things for fixation, one is this patient required thoracotomy for some other reason.
Okay.
There is a major vascular injury, patient has got esophageal injury. Okay, so yes. In that case, if you at all need to do a thoracotomy, in the same time you should fix it. Number one. Number two, what is the advantage of early fixation of this flail segment? Some people are saying that if you go to literature and find there is a role for early fixation. What is the advantage of early fixation of this fracture segment?
So all the problems related to the flail segment, sir, will be addressed, sir, that it will not produce the contusion.
If you place the patient in ventilator, as I said, it requires ventilation for 2 to 4 weeks.
Yes,
it's quite
sir.
A long time for ventilation for this to stabilize.
The ventilation associated morbidities will be less.
So if you do early fixation, what is the advantage? Sir. The advantage are number one, the ventilation time may be reduced.
Yes, sir.
Patient may have early recovery.
Yes, sir.
The pain control will be also better if you do a good fixation.
Yes, sir.
How can you address the fixation in the ribs?
So
what are the method to have a good fixation?
Sir.
You see, the ribs are fractured. So either you can use some strut or plates, or you can oppose the rib ends and apply cyanoacrylate. Bone cement.
Bone cement, cyanoacrylate, yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So these are the ways to address a fracture if you go for fixation. Dr. Shamita, we can continue.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I'm asking about the management of pneumothorax, hemothorax, and how to diagnose those.
Okay, sir. So your patient, you have done the chest X-ray and you detected a pneumothorax on the right side and you have put an intercostal drain, but the patient's respiration is still not improving.
Okay. Okay?
So the patient's, the column is moving well. It is draining a bit of air mixed with blood. Saturation has improved slightly, but there is still some distress on the patient's side. So you clinically evaluate him. And your drain is on the right side and you see that even on the left side, there is diminished air entry. What else are you going to think of? Your initial X-ray did not show any pneumothorax on the left side, only on the right side. What else are you going to think of?
So, ma'am, the pneumothorax on the right side...
has been drained. You put a chest tube.
Okay. We can assume a hemothorax that has developed on the left side, ma'am.
Okay. There are certain things called life-threatening injuries in the thorax and there are certain things called potentially life-threatening. Right?
Yes.
So life-threatening is what you've already said, that it could be a tension pneumothorax, it could be a massive hemothorax, could be a open pneumothorax, mind you, is not a life-threatening. It will give you time. So that is comes under a potential.
Okay.
Life-threatening will be tension pneumothorax.
Cardiac tamponade, ma'am.
Cardiac tamponade, airway obstruction. And massive obstruction. Right,
yes,
massive hemothorax, right?
Yes,
so under potentially, you said one is, as you said, it could be
tracheoesophageal injury, ma'am. Is the myocardial contusion, pulmonary contusion,
yes.
Diaphragmatic injury, and
yes.
Aortic injury, ma'am.
Correct. So these are the potential 8 things which are called the potential life-threatening injuries.
Okay.
Now, when you said diaphragmatic injuries, which side is a diaphragmatic injury more common?
Right side, ma'am.
Right side. Yes. Why is it? Why do you think it is more common?
Right side is more common. Are you sure?
Right side.
Ma'am, not sure. Not sure, sir.
See, think rationally. What do you have on the right side below
liver,
the diaphragm? You have the liver. So liver itself has a protective action.
Yes, ma'am.
Even if there is a diaphragmatic injury, something herniating through that injury into the thorax, the possibility is much less. Whereas in the left side, what do you have? You just have the stomach there.
Stomach.
Right? And part of the spleen approaching
yes,
the diaphragm. So if there is a rupture of the diaphragm there, the chances of structures herniating into the thorax is much more. Will you not try to rule out a diaphragmatic injury? Patient because the respiratory distress is continuing.
Yes,
okay. So if you are clinically suspicious, what are the things which will lead you to a diaphragmatic injury? What investigations will help you? You're clinically suspicious.
Oh, we can do a X-ray, ma'am, again, to see whether
X-ray,
there is...
You had done an X-ray. You had done an X-ray, right? That is how you diagnosed your pneumothorax.
Pneumothorax.
Right. So what are the things in the X-ray that you're going to see?
We can see if there is a herniation, ma'am. We can see the gut or stomach herniating into the thorax, ma'am, left-sided thorax. We can see the air shadows, ma'am. And
Is there any way of confirming? Because it is not so easy to make out.
Yes, ma'am. We can
put
an esophagogastric tube and we can then do an X-ray, X-ray, ma'am. We can see the esophagogastric tube coiling inside the thorax, ma'am.
Right. So your first X-ray had not picked it up, or maybe you were not alert for it. So if you're still suspecting, yes, please put in a nasogastric tube and repeat the x-ray. Yes. If you see the tip of the nasogastric tube in the thorax, that will tell you that probably there is a diaphragmatic injury with the stomach or other part of the gut herniating inside the thorax. Okay. Now this patient has a diaphragmatic injury. What are you going to do? How are you going to manage it?
Do you like to have a CT scan? You see, sometimes stomach may not go. You put the Rels tube, so Rels in the abdomen, but something else has gone up. So to confirm that patient has got a diaphragm injury, ideally you should get a CT of the thorax also. CT thorax is also important.
The only point to be remembered is please send the patient to CT only if he is hemodynamically stable.
Yes.
Remember, a diaphragmatic injury will suddenly not kill a patient, but a hemodynamically unstable patient may suddenly die. So if the patient is stabilized, as sir said, that a Rels tube in the stomach will only be picked up. But if it is a small intestine or the transverse colon or anything else in the thorax, your Rels tube test will not be. So yes, you can do a CT. Okay, well, how else do you manage it? Yeah. So you've done a CT and or maybe your x-ray itself has told you that there is a diaphragmatic injury. How would you like to manage it?
So it will be managed after the patient is stabilized. We'll do a laparotomy and a correction of the defect, ma'am.
You will do
after a reduction of the hernia and correction of the defect.
Correction, what do you mean by correction of defect?
The hernia, we can do a patch repair, ma'am.
Patch repair with what?
Dacron graft. I don't
know. See, there. If the tear is small, yes, number one, you have to identify the tear. Reduce the contents back into the abdominal cavity. Ensure there is no contamination of the thoracic cavity. If the gut that has gone in is perforated or something, so you have to ensure that. You will keep a drain in the thoracic cavity without fail. Yes. And if it is a small tear, it can be done for primary repair using a non-absorbable suture like polypropylene. Yes. If it is a larger repair, yes, you are justified into putting a mesh. Though in the trauma scenario, active trauma scenario, there are some debates about it. Yes. But yes, if it is a large defect, we do err on the side of putting a mesh there. Fine.
This was discussed yesterday in RRC.
Yes.
You were in RRC yesterday?
Yes.
This was discussed in RRC yesterday.
Yes. Right, sir. Okay, so sir was just saying now that if you are opening this patient up to repair the diaphragmatic hernia and this patient has a flail chest, this is a scenario where you will probably also take care of the flail segment intraoperatively.
Intraoperative.
Right? Okay. Yes. What are the other common injuries that come about? You said something about hemothorax. Sir, have we discussed hemothorax, sir?
Hemothorax, we'll discuss. Just. Diagnosis we have discussed. You have to management.
Okay, so you have said that the hemothorax can be classified both as life-threatening as well as potential life-threatening.
Yes.
When will you call a hemothorax life-threatening?
If after putting a drain, if there is more than 1500 ml of blood or there is continuous drainage of more than 250 ml of blood for over 3 to 4 hours, we can.
Correct. Absolutely correct. So either 1.5 liters, the moment you put in the drain, or if you have 200 to 250 per hour for next 3 to 4 hours, which means there is a persistent significant bleed.
Yes.
Now you have put in a tube and you see suddenly blood coming out, gushing out about 1.5 liters. What are you going to do?
We will do a emergency. We will prepare the patient for emergency thoracotomy, ma'am, to seal the bleeding vessels.
What are the sizes?
Bleeding size.
Which are the usual source of bleeding?
Intercostal. Mainly, bleeding is from intercostal vessels or internal mammary vessels.
What else? Internal mammary is more medial. Very unlikely to get injured.
Yes, it is not from the lateral side.
Intercostals and
can pulmonary injury cause bleeding?
Pulmonary
underlying injury lung injury?
Yes.
And if it is a more severe injury, massive bleeding?
The great vessels. Yes. So if coming back to your chest trauma, which part of the ribs do you think is more associated with massive hemothorax or the injury to the great vessels?
Central anterior part.
No, when I'm saying anterior, what I mean is the above ribs, like the first few ribs, one,
oh,
two,
first,
three,
first few
ribs, the middle
first,
or the lower?
First, second ribs, first and yes. second ribs, clavicular fracture.
Yes.
Mainly.
Yes. So if the injury is more confined to the clavicle or to the first few ribs, it is more commonly associated with injury to the great vessels. And the lower ribs injury is more associated with injury of
trachea and esophagus and
heart. You're not listening. The lower ribs, fracture yes. of the lower ribs is associated, more commonly associated with injury of
liver and spleen. Yes.
Exactly. So if you see an X-ray and your abdominal findings are still okay and you see there is a fracture of the 9th and 10th rib, you have yes. to be suspicious that it may be associated with internal organ injuries like the liver or spleen, depending on which side. Okay. Yes. The middle ribs, they take the maximum impact of the force. Okay. So in normal young adults, which part of the ribs are commonly fractured? You've seen these X-rays so many times. Where do you find commonly the fractures?
Lateral part, mainly.
The lateral part. Why is it so? Why is it, even if there is an impact of injury, anteroposterior mechanism of injury, maybe he has a steering wheel injury where his chest hits the steering, but still we find a fracture on the lateral part. What is the reason behind it?
It's the area of least support, ma'am, and because of the curvature, leads to easy fracture on impact.
It is not the area of least support, but the impact makes the ribs move outward. Wow. And when it moves outwards, the angles of the rib where the anterior moves onto the posterior, that is the part which maximum impact occurs there. In children, if you have a child, is rib fracture more common as compared to adults?
No, ma'am. They have more elastic. Their joints are not yet fused, so movement is much more. They can tolerate a wide range of movement, ma'am.
Right. It's more so than movements. They are more cartilaginous in
more
nature.
Cartilaginous.
So yes. the chances of fractures are less. So in yes. children, even though there are no rib fractures, you have to be alert that there may be underlying lung injury.
Yes, ma'am.
So the rib may be spared, but an underlying lung injury may be there. Whereas in adults, if there is no rib fracture, chances of underlying severe lung injury is less yes. as compared to children. Okay, fine. So coming back to your hemothorax, you put in a tube and 1500 has come in and you are preparing the patient for an urgent emergency thoracotomy. Is there any role of clamping the tube while you're waiting for the patient to be shifted? If so, why? No. Okay, why not? Why not? What may happen if you clamp the tube?
The tube may get blocked by the clot, ma'am. So it will further hamper in it. It will cause compression of the major vessels already compromising the existing condition of the patient, ma'am. It will decrease the venous return and cardiac output.
Right. So there is a misconception that if you clamp the tube, maybe that clot itself is going to have a tamponade effect and prevent further bleeding. But that is not right. As you correctly said, it is going to compress on the vessels and decrease the venous return, number one. And moreover, it itself might cause a mediastinal shift. The hematoma that is collecting will cause a mediastinal shift, leading to further deterioration of the patient. So an emergency thoracotomy is what you have to do. You arrange blood, arrange for your OT, and shift the patient to the OT as early as possible. And please do a thoracotomy only if you have a trained person with you in your service. Okay. Sir, have we discussed pneumothorax? Sir?
Pneumothorax, we have discussed. What about the cardiac tamponade diagnosis?
Right. So your patient, I'll just give you a short scenario. This same patient, that 38-year-old gentleman who had that accident, when he came to you, you saw that the pulse was around 120, BP was 90/60, respiratory rate was 30, as you had said, and the saturation was around 88. So you put in you suspected a pneumothorax and you have put in a chest tube, right? In spite of that, you see that the saturation is not improving, though the chest tube is functioning well. So clinically, what are the other things that you're going to look for?
Distended neck veins and muffled heart sounds.
Distended neck veins and muffled heart sounds. What are the two conditions in which you commonly get distended neck veins?
pneumothorax and cardiac tamponade. Tension pneumothorax and cardiac tamponade.
Tension, not all pneumothorax, not simple pneumothorax, not open pneumothorax. Yes. So it is a tension pneumothorax and a cardiac tamponade. So you have already, number one, you put in a chest drain on the right side, but patients, you're saying still on the left side, there is a raised internal jugular and muffled heart sound. Yes. You have to think that either there is an associated tension pneumothorax on that side also, and whether there is a cardiac tamponade. So how will you differentiate one from the other? And if they coexist, how do you identify it?
We can do a e-fast, ma'am. That way we can see the pericardial cavity, whether there is any collection or not. And also on X-ray, there is increased. We can see, obviously, if there is any tension pneumothorax in X-ray, and if there is pericardial tamponade, then there is increased mediastinal length.
Dr. Atik, very first point. If you are suspecting tension pneumothorax, you should not have done a chest X-ray.
Yes, ma'am.
Right? And neither an EFAST, because a tension pneumothorax has to be a clinical diagnosis.
Yes, ma'am.
If you are going to wait for a chest X-ray to diagnose a tension pneumothorax, you may lose the patient. Okay? So a tension pneumothorax is purely a clinical diagnosis characterized by a raised IJV, absence of breath sounds, hyper-resonance on that side.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, if you think that it is hyper-resonant, and even if there is an underlying cardiac tamponade, mind you, the tension pneumothorax is more fatal than the cardiac tamponade. So, sequentially, the tension pneumothorax has to be dealt with first. So, you're going to put in the needle, right, for a tension pneumothorax. Where do you put in the needle?
Second intercostal space along the mid-clavicular line.
Yes, that was what the trend was. It has been modified now by the 10th edition of the ATLS protocol. And they say that you don't put it in the second rib anymore. You put it in the fifth intercostal space. In the mid-clavicular, where you put a chest drain, the needle goes in through that one. The reason being that often when you are putting a needle through the second intercostal space, the needle tip may not penetrate the pleural cavity to reach the airlock. Particularly in young men, muscular people, you have strong pectoralis major there. So the needle may not reach the pleural cavity, often leading to a misconception that there is no tension pneumothorax. Okay? So the lateral part, all you have is the intercostal muscles, so which are not very thick muscles. So it is more possibility of entering the pleural space is much more through the lateral part. So now they've changed it that in a tension pneumothorax, you'll put the needle through the fifth intercostal space where you normally put your chest drain. Yes. In children, we still stick to the second intercostal space because this issue does not arise in children. Okay. Yes. So you put in a tension needle, you see a gush of air. What do you do next?
Then we wait for the patient to stabilize and then we can...
What do you do next? How long will you wait?
For correction of SpO2 and other vital signs.
Hey, are you happy with the needle or do something
else? No, I will do a chest drain.
How long? I mean, you said I'm going to wait for the patient to stabilize. That is not the point.
No, ma'am. For correction of vitals, ma'am.
You will just wait. You give yourself enough time to arrange your things and your assistant.
Okay, ma'am.
So if you can do it within 5 minutes, so be it. Yes. Mind you, this is just a temporary measure. And you cannot expect your saturation and everything to rise and improve automatically. So you will immediately take precautions and start putting on your ICD. So you put in your ICD, your pneumothorax is draining, and you reassess. Every step you have to reassess, and you clinically see that though the IJV has come down partially, it has not come down totally, and your muffled heart sounds are present. So you suspect a cardiac tamponade, right? So what are you going to do next? How are you going to confirm your cardiac tamponade?
We can do a EFAST through the...
Exactly. So this is where the EFAST comes in. The EFAST should not come before management of tension pneumothorax. Okay? Yeah. Tension pneumothorax has to be managed, followed by... Yes, if you say that I put in a needle, I'll confirm by a EFAST and then put in a chest tip, I can give you the license for those 5-10 extra minutes, but definitely not before putting in the needle. So you put done your EFAST. Which are the areas you see under EFAST? What do you mean by EFAST?
EFAST means extended focused assessment with sonogram for trauma. In trauma, we'll assess both lateral aspects of the chest to see for any pneumothorax or any collection. We'll assess the right and left will right and left what to say, I hypochondriac area, the sub xiphoid space and the pelvic space.
Okay, so basically we are looking for fluid.
Yes.
Okay, so we are not looking for specifically for any solid organ injury or hollow viscous injury. All we are looking for in EFAST is fluid. That fluid may be in trauma scenario, the commonest possibility is blood. It may be any other fluid, or in the lungs also, it may be blood or it can be air. Okay, so we are looking for fluid. So in when you are doing the EFAST and you are looking at the subxiphoid area, that is a pericardial window,
yes.
What are you looking for? You're looking for a collection within the pericardial sac. Within the pericardial sac. Okay. How are you going to manage it? You see that the patient has a collection within the pericardial window. What are you going to do?
So, ma'am, it's now said that we need to do a open pericardiotomy via the subxiphoid window or through thoracotomy, because pericardiocentesis it is only an emergency or temporizing procedure.
Are you trained in doing a pericardiotomy?
No, ma'am.
Most of us are not. We are general surgeons, right?
Initially, you have to do a renal aspiration.
Right. So initially,
pericardiocentesis.
Pericardiocentesis. How do you do a pericardiocentesis? This is something you have to know.
Yes,
we will not blame you if you don't know how to do a pericardiotomy. But a pericardiocentesis, how are you going to do a pericardiocentesis?
We will do it through the subxiphoid window between the angle at the angle of at the angle of the rib and the sternum, we'll make an incision and then enter the needle in the pointing towards the left shoulder.
So you insert the needle just before the medium, below the xiphoid, and you direct it towards the left-sided nipple.
Yes, okay? Left-sided nipple. Yes,
so you attach a saline loaded syringe behind the needle.
Yes.
Definitely put the patient, attach the ECG monitors to the patient.
Yes, ma'am.
And as you introduce, you try sucking to see whether any blood is coming in. The moment you enter the pericardial space, you will see blood flowing into your saline loaded syringe. Okay. After, and what else when you're doing this, what else do you have to observe?
The ECG monitor, ma'am.
Yes. So you have to look at the ECG tracing.
Yes.
Because the pericardial space is a very small space. Maybe you've aspirated around 25-30 ml of blood and you see ECG changes coming. That means the space has been emptied and your needle is now poking the inner layer of the pericardium and the myocardium, thereby leading to ECG changes. Yes. So you immediately have to withdraw your needle. Otherwise, you might inadvertently cause cardiac muscle injury. So you have to keep your eyes on the monitor and do it.
Yes.
You have emptied it and you've called your thoracic surgeon to come and help you out. In the meanwhile, what can you do? Do you keep the needle in situ or do you take the needle out?
We can keep the needle in situ if there is no ECG changes. We can try suctioning.
See, if you keep the needle in situ, there is always a potential for it to cause further injury to the cardiac air. But yes, if you are strictly monitoring the patient, yes, you can keep it in situ with the thing that if it fills up again, you can re-aspirate it. But it is always safer to take the needle out and introduce it again if you are suspecting a refill. Okay, fine. So the cardiotomy, pericardiotomy and that is usually done by the thoracic surgeons and it's outside the purview of our expertise. So we had said that the tension pneumothorax, a massive hemothorax, a cardiac tamponade, and these are the life-threatening injuries. And the potential life-threatening injuries could be a simple pneumothorax, a smaller hemothorax, flail chest, pulmonary contusion, cardiac injury, controlled aortic disruption, diaphragmatic injury, and esophageal rupture. Right?
Yes,
suppose you have a patient who has come with a stab wound on the chest. Okay? So somebody's put a knife in through the lateral aspect of the chest, third intercostal space.
Yes, ma'am.
How are you going to manage this patient? Stab wound on the left side of the chest. How are you going to manage this patient?
This is a open wound in the chest.
Open wound
in the chest.
So what are the problems?
So it can lead to, if it has already injured any major vessel, the chances of salvage is less. But if
patient the patient is hemodynamically stable,
okay,
has been brought to your ER, the knife is still stuck in his chest wall when he has been brought to the ER.
If the patient is hemodynamically stable, ma'am, then we will not remove the knife, and then with it in place, we can do a chest CT scan if possible to see if.
See, the point is, if the knife or anything, the impaling structure is there, do not remove it unless you are in a controlled environment, probably an OT.
Yes.
Reason being, this itself may be having a tampona defect. So if you pull it out, it might suddenly start to bleed torrentially.
Yes.
Okay. So you've taken the patient to a controlled environment, wherever your controlled environment is, and you have taken the knife out. So there is an open wound there. And you clinically examine the patient and you think that there is a pneumothorax, okay? Or even a hemothorax for that matter. What are you going to do?
So if, ma'am, it's, if it's more than 3 centimeter, that means it's causing an open pneumothorax, then we'll just apply a positive, we'll apply a sterile occlusive plastic dressing, ma'am. We'll cover the area maybe with off-site and cover, close it on 3 sides to create a flutter valve effect.
Okay, what is the idea? Why do you want to, so do not say an occlusive dressing totally with off-site.
No.
Because when you say occlusive dressing, that means you occlude the whole lumen. Only in your last sentence, you said that you make it a flutter valve-like. Why do I make it a flutter valve-like? Or it is called a three-side dressing.
That means
you seal it on 3 sides and keep 1 side open.
Yes.
What is the idea being making a three-side dressing?
So that why air is it? Not able to enter the pleural space from outside, but with the expiration, with the inspiration, it is forced outside.
Right. So if you make a total occlusive dressing, you will convert a simple pneumothorax into a tension pneumothorax. So that is something you have to be aware of. Fine. So you put in an occlusive dressing with 3-way seal and 1 side open. Are you planning to put in a chest drain?
Yes, ma'am. In a different side.
A different side. Why not the same side? There is an opening. It is ready for you. You can just push the drain in. So why not the same side?
We have to close it.
You're correct. We put it through a separate side. But what is the logic? Why do we put it through a separate side?
Because then we'll be able to close that opening later.
See, there are a few things to be remembered. Number one, it is not a clean path.
Yes, ma'am.
When the knife or whatever is introduced, it may be a jagged path. So even if you do put in your chest tube, there may be peritubal leakage of air. That is one point. Secondly, it may be a contaminated path, because some foreign body has been introduced. So you would not want to maintain a tube there. Thirdly, it may be associated with fractured ribs as well. So the broken edges of the ribs may also damage the tube and lead to further respiratory compromise. So you are going to dress that area. Suturing or not is a different decision depending on how contaminated it is. You're going to dress or repair that area depending on the situation. And you are going to put in a chest tube through a different space. Now, if the stab injury is through the 5th space where we normally put in a chest tube, yes, you may go in a step higher or a step lower depending on your clinical judgment at that moment. Okay. So never, never, never go in through the same injury. Okay. Sir, have we discussed analgesia in this patient, sir?
Yes, we have discussed.
Okay, sir.
What is Stovin chest?
Stovin chest. Okay.
If it's fractured only on multiple ribs are fractured but not on 2 sides, it's a fracture only on 1 side, then.
And what happens in the chest wall?
Chest one, there is no paradoxical respiration, sir, but it becomes a
Stovin chest. This is an indentation.
Indentation.
There is an indentation in the chest wall, but that is not showing paradoxical movement.
Yes.
But if it is a large Stovin chest, what is going to happen?
It will hinder the movement of the
underlying lung.
Yes.
It will prevent the underlying to expand.
Yes.
So Stovin chest is not like a flail chest, but if it is a large segment of Stovin chest, it can cause underlying lung compression leading to gaseous exchange difficulty.
Yes.
So Stovin chest is more common in younger patients.
Yes, sir.
Okay. In elderly patients, the ribs are more easily fractured.
Okay.
I think we have covered the most of the testing department. Okay, right. We have not asked about the analgesia. I said very good, yes. Analgesia is important. How do you achieve pain control in patient having chest injury?
So we can give IV analgesia, but as there is a, if there a drain is if a drain is in place, we can give intra pleural like topical intrapleural infusion of lignocain to
what else? What is the better way of
patch?
Now people are saying the best way of analgesia control is this. What?
Patch, sir. Fentanyl patch analgesia.
Patch? Doesn't work. Will not cause respiratory depression, will not cause a lot of side effects.
Blocks are...
Yes.
One is, either if you have multiple refractured, yes. How many sites you will block? So if it's a single area, you can block intravascular nerve. The better option for multiple refractures is it give a continuous epidural anesthesia.
Epidural anesthesia.
Okay. So that
but
is
if, if you're putting an epidural anesthesia again, you have to monitor the hemodynamics rigorously because sometimes that might itself cause hypotension.
Yes.
There's something called a WHO analgesia ladder, which you must be aware of. The lowest part in the ladder is something like oral paracetamol and all that. Above that, you have the injectables. Above that, you have the injectables, NSAIDs. Then you have the injectable tramadol. Above that, you come to the opioids. Okay. So in any trauma patients, we have to remember we cannot start lesser than injectable NSAIDs because the pain component in any trauma is so severe that in addition to monitoring your pulse, BP, respiration, saturation, you also have to monitor the pain. Now, this is now considered the sixth vital in addition to pulse, BP, saturation, respiration, and so if the pain control is not good, remember, your hemodynamics will also not improve and there is going to be further chest compromise. So do not start with anything less than injectable NSAIDs. Yes, you can definitely go up to tramadol and opioids if it is available at your center. You can give intercostal blocks. You can give epidural. A patch is okay, but mind you, a patch will take time to act. So even if you do apply a patch now, it's not before 24 to 48 hours that it is going to be effective. And the better analgesia that you give, the patient can be made to undergo better chest physiotherapy, thereby preventing secondary issues like basal atelectasis, pneumonia, or other lung complications. Okay.
Take any question from the audience? Any participant can ask any question? We have discussed almost the whole part of chest injury as is asked in the examination. So if you have conversion with this fracture rib, this pneumothorax, hemothorax, pedicle tamponade, failed chest. So here there are different components you may be asked in the exam. So I hope you have covered the most part. Anybody can ask a question? Okay. If not, we'll end. Dr. Samita, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
This was a nice discussion.
Extremely sorry, sir, for the network issue.
Net issue, we can't help.
All right. Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
One for 1 hour.